Now to our political leaders' interviews. This week we're with Greens co-leader Metiri Atude.
Metiri, thank you for coming on the show. Well, when you think of the Greens, it's easy to think of tree-hugging and hippies, but the party's more than just about the environment, isn't it?
Well, that's right. We see the environment and the community as interlinked. You cannot have a healthy, sustainable environment if you have an unjust, unwell community. So you have to do both those things at the same time. So our charter, for example, talks about ecological wisdom and social justice and decision-making and peace, because we recognise that we have to be engaged in the whole process of wellness.
And one of your key policies is around child poverty. Do you want to explain about what are the different parts of that?
For this election, we've got three priorities for action in the next 3 years, and one of those is to bring 100,000 children out of poverty in 3 years. And we can do that with four solutions. One is to make working for families fairer, and make sure that 140,000 beneficiary families have a slight increase in their income by $60 a week, so that they can actually support their kids. Our other policy is to increase the minimum wage, because so many of our people, our parents, are working full-time jobs on minimum wage and they just don't make enough money to keep food on the table for their kids, and that's just not fair.
So how much do you want to increase it to?
We'd increase it to $15 minimum immediately, and then we would lock in increases so we don't have to keep arguing about increasing the minimum wage.
John Key just released National's welfare policy this week as well. How do you rate that?
Well, I think it's punishing the most poor and the most vulnerable. They are work testing sole parents, parents who want to, who should be able to put their children first. But National Party is saying, no, we're going to drive you out into low-paid, unsustainable work, and we don't care what happens with your kids. They're going to do their same thing with sickness and invalids beneficiaries as well. If we want people to move from the benefit to work, we have to make sure there's jobs. So the second priority that the Greens have for this election, actually, is to create 100,000 green jobs in the next 3 years. So there is work for all our people.
So how is that feasible? Like, you know, we're hearing that there aren't many jobs out there. There's thousands of people applying for even basic kind of jobs. Where are these jobs going to come from?
We've got three main proposals. Extending the home insulation scheme, that will create another 4,000 jobs. Riparian planting, so maintaining the health of our streams and waterways. They're a food source, those places. So improving the health of streams and waterways, but also investing in renewable technologies. There's a $1 trillion global market in new renewable energy technologies, and New Zealand could be part of that and create some 60,000 jobs as a result.
Housing's a big issue for our community. You want to create warmer homes?
Yes, well, the home insulation scheme that we've been working on has been really successful. So there's over 100,000 homes have now been made warmer and drier, some 4,000 people employed, often young men because of the nature of the work, so that's good. It's a job opportunity for our young people. But if we extend it to another 200,000, then we create something like 10,000 extra jobs. And again, many of them go to young men who are in desperate need of work. They might not have a high skill level yet, but they are able to progress through that program.
Now, the Tauranga Reno oil disaster, massive tragedy for this country.
Yeah.
How do you think, National could have done a better job on that, or what would the Greens have done?
Oh, well, they were slow in getting started. They knew that it was a very serious issue. They also knew that we didn't have the resources in this country to deal with an oil spill. And they were warned by Maritime New Zealand about a year ago that they needed to purchase more resources, and the government said no. And then we have this disaster.
How important is the Pacific community to the Green Party?
We've worked really hard and closely with the Pacific community in different kinds of ways. So we've supported citizen rights, for example. That was an issue that was a big issue for the community a few years ago. We've been very active on climate change issues as a result of that. And Pacific countries have been leaders on demanding that developed countries engage with the climate change debate in a much more rational and responsible way. And we have supported those countries doing that, because it is, of course, the Pacific that is going to suffer very significantly and worst and early from climate change effects, like salination of water supply, like rising sea levels. But there's also issues of poverty. You know, many of the people I've met in the cleaning, who are cleaners and who are earning minimum wage, are older Pacific women, and they have families to care for. So we need to take care of both, you know, people's daily needs, but also these bigger issues around the entitlements and rights of Pacific people in New Zealand, and treat the Moana Nui Akiwa as we are cousins, and we need to, you know, have this sense of responsibility with each other.
Thank you so much for coming on today.